Like it or not, we live in a digital age. Through a process that began in the 1950s and 60s and has accelerated since the 1980s, the computer has become an integral part of our society up until the point today where it is as necessary to the functioning of our society as the wheel or plumbing. But as the computer integrates itself more and more fully with society, I believe that we should adopt the values of those who laid the groundwork for the computers that we have today. These were called hackers, but they bear little relation to the petty purse thieves that plague our airwaves today. Instead, they were a group of programmers and scientists based primarily at MIT, but also at other universities and technical institutes throughout the nation and occasionally around the world, who laid the groundwork for most of the computing that we do today. They had a system of values known as the hacker ethic that they believed a computer-integrated society could hold, and that was what they believed computers would bring about. The first value in this ethic was independence. But this is not the sort of independence pictured here that you think of flag in hand when you hear the word. I'm not trying to downplay the importance of that type of independence. Instead, it is merely not what I've come here to talk about. Instead, the independence of which I speak could better be referred to as non-interference. It means that authority should not interfere, hence the term, in whatever it is controlling. It means that managers should not busily micromanage their employees, or government should not have a heavy hand in scientific endeavors. Without this, we cannot do our best work and often end up holding on to outdated ideas. Allow me to illustrate with an example. During the Cold War, the United States and the Soviet Union had two very different approaches to science. In the United States, the government did very little to affect the course of science. It was left generally up to the individual scientists to decide on consensus and such, whereas in the Soviet Union, the government had a heavy hand in scientific affairs. If a Soviet scientist discovered something, especially if it was at odds with Western science, it would generally be accepted, even if it had been disproven years before, simply for the promotion of Soviet communist science over any bourgeoisie science held by the Western world. An example of this is Lysenkoism. Essentially repackaged Lamarckian evolution. It had been known for decades that this was false. However, because a Soviet scientist had discovered it, the Soviet government held on to this as the truth for several decades, and any scientist who did not agree to this had a tendency to wind up in Siberia. The second virtue is unity, but this is not unity as preached by the infamous dictators of the past, such as Hitler and Stalin. Instead, it is a unity of cause, a unity of spirit. Without it, we can't create the great projects that we have created over all of history, including, for example, the internet. While many of you will associate the internet with this man, Al Gore, he, in fact, did not create the internet. Instead, it was created by thousands of programmers and scientists across the world in multiple stages over the course of the latter part of the 80s and early 1990s. Thirdly, there is meritocracy. And meritocracy is judging people based upon their achievements and their skills and not upon any other factor. It can be best broken down into three stages. The first is one that we are already implementing now. It is the elimination of the most obvious and dangerous of the biases, such as sexism, racism, ageism, and religious discrimination. The elimination of these is incredibly important, bordering on being a basic human right. And it is rightfully being pushed by many activist groups within our society. Secondly, we have the elimination of the subtler biases, which are still easier to eliminate, such as the propensity to hire more beautiful people, or nerds on rainy days and jocks on sunny ones. These are well supported scientifically, and though they will take a good amount of energy to overcome, it would still be a good idea, even necessary, to overcome them to ensure a more meritocratic society. Finally is the third stage, which is far more difficult, possibly even requiring a societal overhaul. It requires the abandoning of everything that is not an achievement in the judging of someone, especially in the hiring process, including education, as the achievements should speak for themselves. It would be, as I said, difficult and require a total upheaval of how we view qualification. I am not advocating for this stage, but to change over to it would certainly be a good thing. Now, these three virtues are like the three primary ingredients in a good roast beef sandwich: bread, roast beef, and cheese. Eating just one of them is a little weird and not particularly effective. With independence alone, you are able to do good work, but without others to help you with unity, it is nothing. Unity alone is useless, as authority will destroy anything that you create, and meritocracy alone is useless because you have no achievements on which you can objectively judge. Just two together, either be it roast beef and cheese or any two of the virtues, is better, but still not perfect. But all three together creates a great synergistic effect, which leads to very good results, be it an ideal society or merely a delicious lunch. Now, we need to integrate these values into our society. It will not be easy, but it is necessary. It's necessary that managers stop moving the hands of the employees at their desks. It is necessary that we focus on achievements when judging potential employees. Do as I have told you and reap the rewards. Thank you.